Hello everyone, welcome back to this AI Coffee Break. Today, the topic might appear a bit technical, but if you've ever wondered what energy-based models are and how they differ from standard neural networks, this video is for you. We'll break down how a new paper combined energy-based models with transformers, which are the backbone of large language models, of vision models, and even video generators, to create energy-based transformers. The cool part of them is that unlike standard transformers that always spend the same amount of compute per token, energy-based transformers can think longer before they produce each token, stop early on easy tokens, and even tell us when they're uncertain. Grab a cup of something and let's dive in. Energy-based transformers were introduced in this paper by Alexi Gladstone and colleagues, and the idea is to make transformers part of so-called energy-based models, a class of models that don't directly output probabilities, but instead assign an energy score to how well a guess fits the input. Energy-based models, or in short EBMs, flip the usual way neural networks work. A standard neural net would take an input X, say an image or a question, and directly output a probability distribution Y over possible answers. An EBM, in contrast, takes both X and Y as input, and the model's output is then an energy score to this pair. Low energy corresponds to well-fitting answers, and high energy corresponds to unfitting answers. And the key thing to keep in mind is this. In EBMs, the answer you want to evaluate isn't the output, it's part of the input. And the model's job is not to generate probabilities directly, but to judge how compatible an input-answer pair is. And one can train such an EBM via contrastive pairs. Show it a question with the correct continuation from the dataset, and the same question with a random wrong continuation. Then push the energy down for the correct one and up for the wrong one. But this approach is inefficient because high-dimensional spaces like language and images, they're essentially infinite possible wrong answers. And you'd need an enormous number of negative samples to really teach the model where the good valleys of the energy landscape are. And if you only sample a few negatives, you risk wasting computation on trivial cases that the model could already reject easily, while still failing to cover the important regions of the space. So the alternative training procedure, and the one used in energy-based transformers, is more complicated but much more effective. Here's the idea in a nutshell, and we'll go into more detail in just a second. So instead of relying on random negatives, you treat the prediction itself as an optimization problem. You basically teach the model to shape its entire energy landscape such that gradient descent naturally flows towards the correct answer. So you start with a random guess for the answer distribution, which goes into the energy-based model, which is implemented just as a normal neural network. It could be a transformer. This EBM outputs a scalar, which is the energy, let's say 122 in this example. Then the EBM refines this energy step by step through gradient descent on the energy. And after several steps, you compare the refined guess to the true answer using a standard loss like cross entropy. So we're still in the high level, the details follow immediately, but the idea here is that the model learns to shape its entire energy landscape such that gradient descent on the energy naturally flows towards the correct answer. And because this was a bit quick, let's go slow and in more detail, because the training looks like this. Via training, you want to teach the model to assign high energy to the incorrect token probability distributions and low energy to correct ones. So, at step T0, you feed the EBM the context X, and you also initialize a guess for the probability vector, call it Y hat 0. And now you want to find the probability vector which minimizes the energy under the current EBM parameters. For this, you go step by step, you update the guess Y hat via gradient descent on the energy, subtracting a scaled gradient of the energy from the initial guess. And if you look closely, you notice that this is the standard stochastic gradient descent formula. And while usually you have weights theta that you optimize, this time you have Y. Also, usually you minimize the loss L, this time you minimize the energy E. So now we're doing back prop on the frozen parameters, and we update only the inputs y hat, like one would do for adversarial examples. And after n refinement steps, you end up with y hat n, which is a refined probability vector. So you do a fixed number of steps or stop when the energy does not decrease anymore. And now after having minimized the energy under current EBM parameters, we're ready to see whether the energy assignments make sense and update them accordingly if not. For this, you use the training data to derive a training loss. We compare y hat n against y, which is the true one hot target vector, which we know from the training data, and we're using a standard supervised loss, typically cross entropy for language modeling. And this loss is then used in normal backpropagation to update the model parameters via gradient descent. And this formula looks easy enough on paper, being seemingly the normal gradient descent that we do in training neural networks, but the implementation of this is quite tricky because this loss depends on y hat n, the refined guess after n steps of energy minimization. So that means that the refinement process itself, which was gradient descent on the energy, now sits inside the computation graph. So when we backpropagate through the loss, we're differentiating through those gradient updates. In other words, we need second order gradients, gradients of gradients. And the authors compute these efficiently using Hessian vector products, which scale linearly with model size, so the cost stays manageable. And this was the training of EBMs, but during inference, things change. You no longer have the ground truth y, instead you only have the context x, and the model starts with one or more random guesses for the next token distribution, and each guess gets refined step by step, again by minimizing the energy, until the energy cannot be lowered anymore or for a predetermined amount of steps. Doing it flexibly has a very human-like flavor, because when a problem is easy, the model needs only a couple of refinement steps, and when the problem is hard, it can spend more time, so more computation, to get it right. So this was the way in which EBM training and inference happens. Now, what's the big deal about EBMs, and why would we like to have them as part of transformers? Well, three things. First, EBMs can dynamically allocate more computation to harder problems because hard tokens to generate would need more steps to minimize the energy. And second, they can self-verify. The energy score itself tells the model whether the prediction is good or not, and this can be useful for comparing the quality of different generations. And third, they can model uncertainty. If the energy stays high, the model basically knows it's unsure and the user might find this information useful. Now, back to energy-based transformers, or short EBTs. For making an energy-based LLM, the authors trained an autoregressive EBT from scratch on Red Pajama V2, and as explained before, instead of outputting probabilities directly like an autoregressive LLM would, the EBT took both the input sequence and the probability vector guess as input, and the transformer inside learned to assign low energy if the guess matched the real next token. And during training, the guess probability vector was refined through gradient descent on the energy for a fixed number of steps. And after that, the model weights were updated so that the refined probability guesses moved closer to the true target. So, unfortunately, in this paper, energy refinement is run for a fixed number of steps, and that's a bit of a missed opportunity because the real promise of this approach lies in it being adaptive, spending just a few steps on easy tokens and many more on harder ones. This flexibility would mirror human reasoning, where we go through simple problems quickly but take extra time to work through the difficult ones. And the reason that authors chose fixed numbers of steps is because EBMs are not known for stable training behavior, and the fixed number of steps helps with training stabilization. And to further stabilize EBT training, the authors had to use three well-established tricks, and let's go through them one by one. First, adding noise to the refinement step. If you always update the guess deterministically, you risk the model getting stuck in some local value of the energy landscape. And by adding a bit of random Gaussian noise at every gradient step, a technique called Langevin dynamics, the model is forced to explore slightly different directions and go into territories around the usual explored data. So the noise encourages to explore more of the surroundings of the training data instead of just overfitting. Instead, it learns to handle more diverse cases, which are cases that it might encounter at test time. Second, the authors use a replay buffer to stabilize training. Normally, every refinement starts from a completely random guess, but if the model only ever sees that, it won't learn how to handle partially optimized states, which is exactly what happens during inference when guesses are gradually refined. So to fix this, they store past predictions and intermediate guesses in a buffer. And during training, the model sometimes starts refinement from one of those saved states instead of pure noise. This exposes it to a richer variety of in-progress situations and helps it generalize better. And third, randomizing the step sizes. If every gradient descent update has the same fixed step size, the model could learn one very rigid optimization path, which is brittle. If you change the number of steps of the difficulty of the problem, the model might fail. So instead, the authors randomize the step size and the number of steps. And this forces the model to cope with different trajectories of the optimization, making it robust to variations and better at generalizing. And together, these three techniques regularize the energy landscape. The noise keeps it from learning only narrow basins around training data that do not generalize at test time on test data. The replay buffer ensures the valleys are well-shaped even midway down, and random step sizes prevent the model from memorizing one descent path. So, what about the results? Honestly, the paper reports quite a confusing mix of different figure sizes, using different model sizes, training setups, and data budgets. But the overall rough picture is this. On validation perplexity, a vanilla transformer wins at first, but then the EBT catches up. And if this trend continues for more than just 6 billion training tokens to something like trillions, the range in which we usually train LLMs, it could look amazing for EBTs, but right now we just don't know. And sure, right now EBTs are about 10 times more expensive in flops than a transformer at the same perplexity, but their scaling rate is, at least on this graph, slightly steeper. So the more you train them, the more efficiently they might improve. That means at trillion token scale, they might actually surpass transformers both in quality and efficiency, but who knows, these lines are fit over 5 data points. Also, EBTs can benefit from more energy refinement steps before committing to the next tokens, while vanilla transformers always have a constant budget and performance per token. On GSM8K, big bench math, and syntax tasks, EBTs' results look good, though I am a bit confused by the experimental settings of this paper and would like to see results at larger data and model scales to be actually convinced. And EBTs aren't just for text. The authors also tested autoregressive video models and bidirectional image transformers. And on these preliminary experiments, EBTs again appear to scale better and generalize better than diffusion transformers or standard VITs. But as before, I'd need larger scale experiments to be convinced. So all in all, EBTs could be a recipe for models that don't just guess, but actually think dynamically, adjusting the effort, self-checking predictions, and admitting uncertainty. In other words, it would be closer to human-like System 2 thinking, and that's what the authors motivate the entire paper with. And to me, it's a bit too philosophical, to be honest, especially since they have no experiment with dynamic on-the-fly allocation of compute, which is a bummer. Of course, there are still challenges. Training and inference are more expensive, hyperparameters need careful tuning, and large-scale experiments are still missing. So the direction looks promising, but I'm not yet fully convinced at this point from the experiments which are currently presented in the paper. But what do you think of energy-based models? Did they convince you as them being the next do-it-all architecture replacing autoregressive transformers? Let me know in the comments. And if you like this paper breakdown, give the video a like and hit subscribe for more AI coffee breaks. So see you next time. Okay, bye.